You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
For the community, by the community.
Thanks for joining us for another episode of Two Guys and a Lotta Wine. I'm Bobby P.
And I'm James Kimbrough.
And I am very pleased and honored to have not only a very good friend and very established attorney here in the Hartford area, but also winner of the gala at West Hartford Community Television's gala back in fall, who was very generous in contributing money to the West Hartford TV station and won both appearance on our show and some, I hope, some very good bottles of wine, Chris.
Thank you, Bob.
And we're turning up the wine snobbery a bit on
we
this
are.
Episode, as you can see
we
the jacket. And we're going to be doing a show we've talked about for a long time on expensive wine glasses, and is there a difference in taste as compared to your standard wine glass? And Jim, I'm very excited about this show.
We're going to do a little side-by-side demonstration tonight. We're going to try Riedel wine glasses and regular wine glasses. And Bob and Chris, you guys will see the difference that a Riedel glass makes. And you know, we try not to get too snobbish on this show, but I think this is one night where we have to get just a little more snobbish.
Every once in a while, we need to put our jackets on and turn up the snob factor just a bit, Chris. And you're our guinea pig tonight, too.
So. Sounds good to me.
We're excited about it, and I think we're going to learn something tonight, which is always good.
Right. So the glasses we have tonight, these are all from the Riedel Company. Riedel started manufacturing wine glasses back in the mid-50s, 1950s. And before that time, every wine glass you saw was pretty much the same shape. Sometimes they're a little bigger, sometimes they're a little smaller, but they were all, the bowl of the glass was pretty much the same shape.
Thickness, too, was probably similar?
Pretty much,
generally.
Yeah. And when Klaus Riedel went out to design his hand-blown glasses, he realized every grape varietal needs to hit a different part of the tongue to get optimal taste, optimal balance, to give you the best kind of experience drinking that wine. So he sat down with a bunch of other wine experts, and they came up with a lot of different shapes for each varietal, and they played with it and tested it, and they finally settled on what they figured were the optimal shapes for each varietal. And we're going to start off tonight with Sauvignon Blanc glass. So, Bob, why don't you pour Sauvignon Blanc for yourself and Chris in a regular glass and then in the Riedel. And I'll drink along with you guys. I only have two glasses.
Chris,
so
what kind of glasses do you use at home?
I use the regular.
You use the regular, yes. Okay. As most of us do.
And try the regular glass first, Bob.
Glass.
Oh, that's the Chardonnay.
I skipped the wrong
that's
one.
That's all right.
We're going to switch it up a
that's
bit
all right.
first.
Okay. All right, Chris, give that a shot.
Sure.
Bob, give that a shot. That's the, this is the Cupcake Sauvignon Blanc. This is under $10. Go ahead and give that a little swirl.
And that tastes like the cupcake I'm familiar with right off the bat.
Right. You get some acidity with that, a little lemon.
This is great. Actually, shout out to my wife. It's one of her favorites, the Sauvignon Blanc from Cupcake.
It's not too strong. It's not too strong at all. It's kind of a nice mellow flavor on the tongue.
Oh, fruity.
All right. Now let's try this in a Riedel, do a little comparison taste.
Now, is there any procedure that's different when using a Riedel? Should you swirl it all when it comes to a...
Absolutely. You want to get some aroma off the wine. You know, normally you're going to swirl more with a red than a white, but give it a little swirl. The Riedel was designed to do four things, to give you better aroma, better taste, better balance once the wine is in your mouth, and a better finish. And so you should notice all those characteristics when you try this in the Riedel glass.
Well, it's probably hard to see on camera, but it does look like the wine is actually sticking to the glass a little bit more.
You get better legs. This is actually lead crystal. you know, this is a regular wine glass. It's just regular glass. So the lead crystal is going to help enhance the flavor as well.
And that's actually important because people might think, now, what's the difference now, this glass or that glass? Right. But if there's wine sticking to a glass, it's affecting the flavor of the wine because it's opening it up.
Exactly.
It's affecting the composition of the wine and the chemical breakdown actually in the wine itself. Yep. So let's see if the chemical breakdown makes a difference in our throat.
I notice a difference.
All right.
Maybe it's psychological, but the glass, it feels lighter, thinner. The wine seems to come into the mouth a little.
That's a good point,
gently,
Chris.
Yeah. I think is a way to put it.
And it's hitting the right part of your tongue too. That's what this glass was designed to do.
It also appears thinner. Do you think that has something to do with it, or?
You can look and see. This is a very thick glass, as opposed to yours.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah. I notice a difference.
All right.
I'm going to say yes, though I still need a little bit more experimentation this evening to be sold. So I know there has to be a difference a little bit because of the legs on this glass as compared to the legs on this glass. So I know what I was drinking in this glass has already been affected by the glass itself. So there should be a difference in taste. So I'm going to wait to the second one to see if I notice something a little bit more pronounced, which we should because it's a Chardonnay.
Okay, go ahead and pour Chardonnay in two regular glasses.
Okay. Actually, this was a Chardonnay that I poured in the wrong glass the first time, wasn't it? I believe it was.
Oh, that's right.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
okay.
That's a Chardonnay.
Do you want me to move these?
Yeah, sure. I'll take those. And I'll try a little too, Bob. You want to pass that down? Now, this is a South African Chardonnay. We haven't done a whole lot of South Africans on the show. But let's give this one a little swirl in the regular glass first.
There is a nose on that.
You get something, right off the nose.
I do tend to like a lot of wines that do come from South Africa. This does have a little butter characteristics that I know is not my favorite, but I think right now it's a little bit more pronounced in the buttery characteristic than I would generally like.
Yeah.
But it still has a good flavor, so I'm very curious to see how that's going to change in the glass that we're going to be drinking out of. Now, this is strictly a Chardonnay.
That's all this glass was designed for,
it's
Chardonnay. And we've got a couple of different series of glasses that Riedel makes. They make the Venom series. Then the first glass that we drank out of was from the Venom series. This particular glass is from the Venom Extreme series. You can see it's got kind of that angled shape at the bottom. So it's a more modern look.
It's a beautiful glass. But,
yeah, it's gorgeous.
What about the glasses specific to Chardonnay?
Well, it's the size of the bowl as well as the diameter of the rim. And then when you tilt it back, it will put the wine on the correct part of your tongue. So they've somehow figured out exactly how to blow the glass into a shape that's going to get it on the right part
so
of your tongue.
So as the wine is actually entering your mouth, the curvature of the glass is affecting where it hits your tongue.
Right.
As compared to just a standard wine glass.
Yep.
Wow.
It's very interesting. I'm going to have another sip of this before I taste it in the Riedel.
I'll follow you.
I get a little butter with this too. Not overly buttery though. Some Chardonnays can be much too buttery for my taste as well. I like this. It's got some minerality to it, and I get a little grapefruit towards the end.
I'll give you that. There is a little grapefruit in this. Not quite as much as I would generally like, but it is a Chardonnay. So it's going to be a different characteristic flavor anyways.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because generally our viewers, you don't normally see these many glasses on the table. And it's a little confusing at first, but I think as the evening goes on, you'll get where we're going because the Riedel glasses themselves stand out so beautifully. Mm. And so let me finish this. Are you a Chardonnay guy yourself, Chris?
Generally speaking, I usually stick with the reds. I'm familiar with some Chardonnays because my mother drinks Chardonnay, but not consistently. But this tastes a lot different than what my mom usually drinks. She drinks a lot of Kendall Jackson Chardonnays.
Yep.
So is there something, maybe to a more sophisticated palate than myself with the Chardonnays? Is there something about the South African that makes it?
Well, there's a lot of there's a lot of different ways to make a wine, and the terroir certainly comes into play. This is Bob's favorite word.
It's my favorite word.
So you'll see different regions producing the same grape, and it'll taste completely different. But then there's also a lot that goes into the blending process, and the winemaker's trying to achieve a certain taste, and so they'll blend certain types of grapes together to achieve that. Even if they're using 100% Chardonnay in this case, They might source grapes from one area and then a little bit from someplace else just to blend together to get the taste that they're looking for.
Oh, and it's fascinating, quickly, as you mentioned your mom liking Kendall Jackson Chardonnay. Yeah. We have some friends also that seem to really like Kendall Jackson Chardonnay. And I'm not sure if that's because that's what your mom has just been familiar with. Has she tried other Chardonnays? And one of the reasons we did this show was to get people to try different types, either Chardonnays or Sauvignon Blancs, because there was such a wide variety out there. Hmm. I don't know if you can answer that question, but it's just when you mentioned Kendall Jackson, I said, wow, I know three or four people that's all they drink is Kendall Jackson Chardonnay.
It might be the familiarity of it. I don't know. You
got to change that.
Yeah, well, it sounds like it. Well, I have some ammo.
His mom will be watching this show, so.
That's right.
Change, Miss Williams.
All right, go ahead and give this a shot.
Okay, great.
And see if this glass makes a difference for you.
Wow.
It's impressive just watching you drink that in that glass.
I got to be honest with you. This is completely different tasting than the first glass.
Yeah, these glasses.
This is a Mr. Science moment right here.
It is.
It feels almost like a crisper.
I got to say it's smoother almost.
Yeah. These are designed to kind of give more depth to the wine, really let the wine open up. There are little hidden nuggets in every bottle, and a lot of times it gets drowned in the glass that you're drinking it out of.
You know, I went into the show a little bit on the skeptical side, but I got to be honest with you. Now that I've had my second drink in a Riedel, the difference is that profound to me.
Yeah.
And we're not on the payroll of Riedel or anything like that. So this is really impressive.
And you mentioned profound. That's exactly the word Robert Parker used when he first tried Riedel glasses. He said, these glasses will have a profound impact on every fine wine that you drink.
I don't know about you, Chris, but remember I mentioned the buttery taste?
Yeah.
I don't get that at all now.
I don't either.
It's fascinating.
It really is. It's interesting. And, you know, because it's a thinner glass, I feel like I have to handle it a little bit more carefully.
You have to be delicate, yeah.
Yeah, so maybe that slows down the sipping process a little bit, makes you enjoy it a little bit more. If that's a secondary benefit.
Well, Jim, I know we've talked about doing this show for a while, and I got to say, so far, now that I've tried the Chardonnay, which I generally would only give like maybe a C to,
mm-hmm.
that Chardonnay, which was a C, has been bumped up to a B, possibly even a B plus.
Well, you've got to drink out of Riedels more often, and you and I both need to drink more Chardonnay.
Well, the problem is we have so many parties and so many people. How many Riedel glasses do you want to put out for people? That can be a very expensive evening.
It is, and these glasses are expensive. I'm not going to sugarcoat this. The glasses we're drinking out of tonight range anywhere from $25 to $35. This is the Venom series. If you get into the Sommelier series, the glasses are over $100 per bottle, per glass, so they get very expensive. And I don't recommend, if you're new to wine drinking, this is not the first thing you should be going out and buying.
That's true, absolutely.
Go out and just get a bunch of regular glasses and try a bunch of wine and figure out what you like, and then you can move up to this later.
It's good that you mentioned that because, you know, some people who might be just getting into wine, which is, you know, once again why we did this show, oh, I got to go buy some Riedel glasses because, you know, Bob and Jim and Chris said, oh, it's fantastic. No, I would still do a little experimentation trying your normal glasses and getting a little bit more in tune to the different wine varieties before you jump into this.
Yeah.
But for some of our people out there who drink a lot of wine or more of a, I don't want to say professional, but more...
They've got a lot of wine under their belt.
Got a lot of wine under their belt. You will notice a difference. You will notice a difference.
All right. This one is a Pinot Noir. This is the Hobnob Pinot Noir, which comes from France.
Which we've had.
I want to thank Kate, a good friend of ours, who introduced us to Hobnob probably 6 years ago. I had never heard of it.
Has it been 6 years?
Yeah, I think so. She brought it over to your house, and I've been serving it on a regular basis ever since. So thank you, Kate.
Oh, I can't believe it's been 6 years. Now, the aroma in this is sort of a little compacted because of the glass.
Right.
So it sort of hits you a little bit.
More concentrated.
Astringently, I think, maybe.
Yeah.
Concentrated, yeah.
This is not typical of Pinot Noirs either. When you try Hobnob, it tends to be a little sweeter than most Pinot Noirs.
That's really good.
No, see, it is really good, which mm-hmm. Hobnob generally is. But is really good going to be kicked up to, oh, sweet chicken vindaloo there.
Divine.
After we have out of the Riedel.
Yeah, I get a lot of cherry with this. And a little bit of vanilla. Which is one of the reasons I keep coming back to it. It's got a great mouthfeel. It's kind of velvety, and I love that vanilla flavor.
Yeah, Chris, you might agree with me or not disagree with me, but do you find your mouth is still tasting that red?
I do.
Red?
Yeah.
Both in the cheeks here.
Yep. Yes. All right, we'll try it in the Riedel now.
Okay.
Mm.
Not as profound as a Chardonnay, but once again, I think this glass has mellowed it out a little bit. Mm-hmm.
I have to agree with you. It's not as noticeable as the Chardonnay, but it does. It's more flow.
You know, part of it is obvious. I mean, the bowl size is so much larger than this, and so you've got so much more room for the wine to breathe, and just getting a lot of oxygen in the wine helps with the taste.
Which is, even without Rito, people should realize that in general, you do want to use a more open glass for red wine. Mm-hmm. Generally, when we do the show, you know, depending on how well I'm prepared, I sometimes only bring one style of glass. But there are red drinking wine glasses and white drinking wine glasses. And anything that opens up a red will taste a little differently than anything that's compressed or compacted like this size. But I will say there is a difference with this too.
Yeah. All right, why don't you pour the rest of your Pinot Noir in the Pinot Noir glass. Okay. And we'll recycle these. I didn't bring enough glasses.
That's okay.
That's okay.
Oh, I was going to use your...
Oh. See, live television people.
Do you have one more glass over there for
us?
Okay.
Yep. And this is a Pinot Noir. This is a California Pinot Noir?
This is a cab. This is the Shooting Star Cabernet Sauvignon. It's from California. I have never tried it, so this will be a first for me tonight. Mm.
And how did you hear about this one?
This is a recommendation from Tony at Supercellars. So thank you, Tony.
And you may have seen Tony on our show from a few months back when we did Italian wines, correct?
Yep.
Same thing.
And he will be back again.
Very mild aroma. More like a black cherry on this one.
Yep.
Distinctly different than obviously the Pinot Noir.
A lot of tannin at the end of this. Do you get kind of an oaky taste in your mouth?
I do. Yeah. It's a stronger taste.
Did you get it right up front?
I do.
Right
at the top of the top of the mouth, front of the tongue.
Can I ask a novice question?
Sure.
Now, when you guys swirl the wine glasses, is there a certain amount of times supposed to be done?
No. This is,
I always wonder about that. You know, it was like three times, four.
It's total snobbery.
Okay. Yeah, it is total snobbery.
The more you swirl, the more of a snob you are.
Since I'm here, I'm like, okay, I'm going to do what these guys are doing.
Depending on what restaurant you're at or which house you're at, you know, there are a number of swirls which may say, you know, big snob or small snob.
Yep.
But there's no difference.
It could also be boredom. Maybe you're bored and you've got nothing better to do than just swirl your wine.
I just wondered if there was an art to it as far as the number of times. So, okay. Well, thanks.
Rome was a little different, obviously, because it's a bigger glass.
And this has a very lingering finish, but it's all at the front of the mouth.
It really is.
So.
Now, I see, once again, I notice this one is distinctly more in my face as I did with the Chardonnay.
Mm-hmm. With the Rito glass.
With the Rito glass.
Okay.
The standard wine glass, powerful punch right in the top of my tongue or front of my tongue. This sort of has opened it up a little bit and has sort of given me more of a coating evenly in the back of my throat.
Now, just as a point of reference, what a lot of old world Europeans will do is they'll drink out of a wine glass.
I've seen that.
It's just a regular glass. And when you smell this, you get almost nothing on the nose. Give that a smell.
Oh.
So you can see that versus a regular wine glass. You get more aroma just from a regular glass. And then when you go to the Riedel, it just kicks it up another notch.
Well, I'm going to also probably guess that one of the reasons for that is like old school Europeans are drinking just more so for the social aspect or with the food. They're not really sniffing the wine or anything like that. But you're right, you don't smell anything in a glass like that. Nothing at all.
That just goes to prove how important stemware is and what a difference it can make in enjoying the wine.
Well, I know we didn't have obviously the opportunity to do everything that Rito makes, but do they also make a champagne flute?
They do make champagne flutes, and they recommend, you know, if you're just getting started collecting wine glasses, you should have the five basic glasses, and it's the four that we did tonight: Sauvignon Blanc, Chardonnay, Pinot Noir, and the Cabernet Sauvignon / Merlot, as well as a champagne flute. I didn't want to get into champagne tonight, but rest assured that I've got the bases covered. So.
Well, you know, it's funny for our Downton Abbey fans, you know, which I am one of, if you've watched some of the shows, they have drank champagne out of your wide champagne glasses that you brought in one time. I don't know if we ever had a chance to drink out of them.
We can do that. We can do a side-by-side tasting. That'd be a fun show.
I know that's sort of a turn-of-the-century thing where, you know, obviously if you drink champagne out of a wider glass, it's going to disperse the bubbles. But
drink fast.
I wasn't very happy with the season finale, by the way, but that's for another time. But this is very good. This is very good out of this glass.
Now, Bob, did you notice a difference more with the Pinot Noir or the Cab?
Oh, the Pinot Noir, not so much. Okay. The Cab almost as distinctly different as the Chardonnay. The Chardonnay still, I still might have to go back and do that again.
Yeah, we can do that again.
Only because I was really shocked at the difference. And you know I'm not a big Chardonnay guy.
Yeah.
That's on the buttery side.
Right.
But if you could take a buttery Chardonnay, which I thought that was, and bring it down to my palate level, that's fantastic. However, if there are people who like buttery Chardonnays, they might find the complete opposite.
Well, they might find that it enhances the wine in other ways, and they'll probably appreciate it for those other differences. So we've got just a little bit of time left, and I wanted to talk about cleaning these glasses. A lot of times people say just throw them in the dishwasher. I don't recommend doing that. Riedel says all these glasses are dishwasher safe. I prefer to wash them by hand, and I recommend using a dish soap that doesn't have any kind of dye in it or fragrance. The fragrance will impregnate the glass, and then the next time you have a glass of wine, it's going to taste like lemon or orange or mountain mist or whatever flavor your soap happens to be. I recommend using something, this is from wineenthusiast.com, but there are plenty of other soaps out there that don't have any kind of fragrance, and you can just hand wash the glasses real quick, and then to finish it off, put a pot on the stove, make a little steam, open up the spout, and then just tilt the glass, and you want to do this up pretty high so you don't burn yourself, and get a little steam inside the glass, and then wipe it out with a cloth.
You know, Jim, I was wondering where you were going with that pie when I first saw it. And I was not expecting that. That's fascinating.
It is. It's a great way to just get a nice polish on the glass right before you serve wine.
I mean, you might want to use a little bit fancier teapot if you're going to do Riedel glasses. But I think people get the general idea. That is absolutely fascinating. Fascinating. I never thought that's where you were going with the teapot.
I wasn't going to boil the wine.
Or drink out of it.
So, Chris, did you have a favorite wine tonight that we tried?
I did. I liked the Cab.
All right.
I thought it was great. And for whatever reason, I was a little suspicious because of the label on it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was a little more cartoony, and I don't know, because it's my own prejudices, but I thought it was really great.
They say never judge a wine by its label.
Yeah,
you know, that's true, Jim, and I think a good example of that is at the charity event a few weeks back, the Mommy Juice.
Yeah. Yeah, great wine.
It was a great wine, and people thought that might be a little gimmicky, but it's not. It's actually an established person who designed the wine, and a California vineyard produces the wine.
Yep.
And I thought it was really good, really good.
And the people kept asking for it, too, all night long. They kept coming back. Give me some more Mommy Juice.
And I believe it was a blend. You could look for that online. It's called mommyjuice.com, and they make a couple different varietals. But it was actually very good. And, you know, I'm going to go back to this. I think this was the Cab. Yeah, it's so much more stringent from the smaller glass.
It really is. Did you have a favorite wine tonight?
I actually like the Chardonnay, and I'm not a Chardonnay drinker, but I knew what to expect from the Hobnob and the Sauvignon Blanc, because I've had those before, but the Chardonnay was new for me, and I really enjoyed that.
You know, I will probably agree with you. The Chardonnay, I'm going to put on my top tonight only because I'm not a Chardonnay guy. To have such a big difference in flavor, and so noticeable difference in flavor so quickly, that Chardonnay went up to a B+ for me. So good job, Jim.
All right. So thumbs up on everything tonight.
Yes.
You know, thumbs up on everything and the fact that we finally got to do our Riedel Glass Show, which we've been talking about for so long. And actually, that might actually segue into our next month's show. I think we're going to be having somebody from the Culinary Institute come on the show, I believe.
Yes. We're going to do some food-wine pairing again. So we'll see how that goes.
We won't be cooking on the show because we know that generally turns out to be a disaster when you start cooking actually live.
And it's a liability.
It is a liability. Yeah. That's true. We don't want anybody to catch on fire.
Thank you for having me on the show.
Chris, thank you for joining us
tonight.
Appreciate
it.
Are there any questions you had in particular about wines tonight?
Well, the swirl was a big one for me.
The swirl?
Yes.
I never told you about the swirl before.
I think you... No, I've usually just copied what you did. So, no, and never. We didn't have any specific discussions, but I always sort of emulated, so I want to know about that. And you know, it's funny. The wine glass size difference is something that I've always wondered about, and you guys educated me on it.
And now you know.
Yeah, and now I know. Appreciate it.
That's what's great is when you see the difference and taste the difference of the wine in the size glass. It's pretty impressive.
It is.
And you know, I also want to thank you again for not only attending the West Hartford Community Television Gala, but also being more than generous and bidding on an item, winning, and being able to be a guest here on the show.
You guys have a great show, and I enjoy
watching it. That's very nice of you.
Come on.
And, you know, it was very generous of you to donate and to be here.
Well, it's been a lot of fun. Thanks for having me.
Well, generally, we would actually sometimes taste a fifth wine. But since we don't have a fifth wine open, I think before the show wraps up and we're close to the end, I think I would like to try one more little splash of that Chardonnay.
All right. Okay. Pass that down.
Maybe that's how we'll end the show, on the Chardonnay again.
Well, I just wanted to tell everybody, please friend us on Facebook. We need you to like us and share us. If you have any questions for us, please send us a message through Facebook. You can also watch previous episodes online at whctv.org or on youtube.com.
And we are also available for any fundraisers that are in the local area.
Absolutely. We've done 3 or 4 now and have had a blast doing them.
We love talking about wine and sharing our experience and our tasting expertise.
And just showing up and meeting people.
And you're effective. You're effective.
And we look good.
That's right.
That doesn't hurt. So what are your plans for the holiday coming up, or for Easter? Anything? Or
Easter?
You can include any type of wine?
Well, I think what I'm going to do is, after the show, I'm going to get some new glasses. And then I'm going to impress my relatives with my knowledge.
Well, you know, it never hurts, because like I said, when it comes to doing wine and the glasses that you serve, there is that snob factor. Mm-hmm. And what's one of the things we've always talked about. And this is an example where the snob factor actually works out, because the wine is better in the bigger glasses.
It really is.
And it's unfortunate you can't actually see the difference in the thickness of the glass on camera, because there really is such a significant difference compared to this and these glasses. And obviously that makes a difference in taste.
It really does.
So I'm glad you're able to join us today, Chris.
Thanks for having me.
Jim, once again, phenomenal. Glad we were able to do the Riedel glasses finally.
And prove it.
And prove it. And once again, we are honest here. We're not making it up.
No.
So I want to thank both Chris and Jim for, once again, a great idea for a show. And until next time, I'm Bobby P.
And I'm James Gimbrough.
And
keep us in your wine cellar.